Let me introduce you to the Audi S6. But don't be fooled. This isn't just any Audi S6. This is Kashyap's fire-breathing, asphalt-tearing beast, meticulously crafted by the legendary tuner Philippos Mathai, better known in the underground as Phil from Speed Sport. Now, what makes this S6 so special, you ask? It's got a split personality, multiple driving modes that you can switch on the fly. On its most conservative setting, it's already a monster, churning out a staggering 600 brake horsepower and over 800 newton meters of neck snapping torque. But wait a minute, that's the conservative setting. Put it on its maximum settings and you're doing approximately 800 brake horsepower and somewhere close to 1000 newton meters of torque. Every tweak, every fine tune has transformed this car into a machine that's as ferocious as it is refined. This isn't just a car, it's a statement, a symphony of speed and a whole lot of madness rolled into one. So strap in tight, because what you're about to experience is pure automotive adrenaline.
Easy, pleasant drive.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, it is. See, you drive it normally, it's like pretty
good. Outside, it's crazy loud.
Yeah.
When you floor it.
Yeah. Inside, it's bearable.
But this is quite pliant, yeah. On the road, it's like
you don't feel that you're going fast. You just cruise around without any issues at all. Like you're driving right now, it's like a normal.
Damn, bro.
Yeah. Plus, you can raise the car whenever you have those crazy bumps and everything. So,
that's
stock.
Such a suspension, there's no upgrade.
There is an option, I think, of a coilover or something. But again, that you lose that character of a touring car sort of a thing.
Marge.
Yeah. This is like comfortable. You go over potholes, you go over anything, jumps and all. But you don't feel a thing.
Damn good.
Like for me, again, it's always the build should be drivable, usable on a daily basis. It shouldn't be that I'm having a problem or I can't take it here, I can't take it there.
True.
Or I can't drive it in traffic. Right now, it's like nice and sedated. And whenever we need to go fast, we can go fast. Man, crazy traffic on the expressway.
Is it because this will be closer to Noida or?
We are.
Seedha se le sakte
hain? I think seedha leke andar hi leta hai. Whenever you need to in comfort also, it's quick enough. It's just that the steering is in comfort mode.
Okay.
And you floor it and it's quick.
Whoa! There's hardly any lag.
There's lag. But once you're in that reverie, then it's like all the way till the red line, you keep on going mad.
Because I think then I'm used to a lot of lag. So right now you're running on what map?
This is a custom map right now.
Meaning as in what numbers? Because you have
600
multiple maps,
horsepower.
Right?
Yeah. So again, we experimented with a lot of these leading brands. Okay. I have the DS1 dongle also, which are like itself switchable maps. You plug and play. That's like the easiest thing. You don't need to go to a tuner. You straight away plug in the dongle. You can select what RON rating you're running on, high boost, low boost, everything. You just buy that 1100 dongle.
Okay.
It has everything for you, like from a stage 1, stage 2, stage 3, and even custom maps.
That's so then essentially thing. It's a standalone ECU?
Not a standalone. It just has those, it's just a tool for putting those maps.
Okay.
Maps get downloaded, you immediately flash them on your ECU.
Okay.
Then we tried out APR also, but again, everyone tries to push for a peak number.
So it's not like a switching map on the fly kind of a thing?
On the fly, it's in your phone. I'm saying 5 minutes, you can flash a map.
Perfect.
APR we also tried running, but again, all these tuners, everyone wanted peak horsepower and peak numbers.
Okay.
Which again, once in a while, it's usable for me because I don't floor the car all the time. I want to drive it on a daily basis also.
Yeah.
So we went ahead with a conservative map, which is like a speed sport custom map.
Okay.
Like low figures only as of right now, some 800 nm torque, 8850 nm of torque.
Okay.
600 horsepower, which is usable enough. Okay. This is currently running on that same setup.
600, right?
Yeah, 600 as of right now. Whenever we want to push it further, we can.
So one is a 600. How many maps do you have?
I'm seeing DS1, Stage 3, there are high boost, low boost maps and different RON ratings.
Okay.
From 91, 95, 98 RON.
Okay.
Then the APR also we ended up purchasing because we wanted to just see how the map is.
Okay.
And then again, what speed port custom map. So we can change everything on the fly as of right now.
Wow. Interesting.
Yeah.
So talk me through a little bit what all...
It's got the RS7 turbos.
It's from factory?
No, not from the factory. It came with the smaller turbos. It's almost essentially same or a similar engine as the RS6, RS7 platform, V8 one turbo.
So you sourced the turbos from an RS7 essentially?
From aftermarket, like a vendor.
Got it.
But essentially it's the same RS7 turbos.
Essentially, okay.
Yeah. Barring that, we've done like a lot of cooling mod, then we've upgraded the waste gates.
Talk to me through the cooling mod, because that was something crazy.
A challenge for this, and what we felt is that the car, in terms of the engine space and everything, is very restrictive.
Okay.
Like, it's very tough. There's no space inside, even like when you want to service the car or change anything at all.
Okay.
You just have to put in the service mode and get the engine down.
Okay.
Because you don't have space enough. So what that does also is getting in air in terms of like cleaner, colder air.
Hmm.
Second of all, the car, because it's running a massive engine, it's a challenge in terms of keeping out the heat.
Okay.
On keeping the IATs cool.
Okay.
So we found this, it's called some FI interchiller or something.
Okay.
Which we sourced. It's a plug and play kit.
Okay.
Which basically takes in the air from the compressor.
Okay.
And throws it to your IATs. So it always keeps the IATs at a lower temperature, so you can always push the car, specifically in the weather.
Just for the viewers, what exactly is an IAT in layman terms?
Intake air temperature.
Okay.
Or intake ambient temperature, or whatever you want to call it.
Got it.
So basically colder air going inside, keeping the car happier, cooler, always in power, so it doesn't get overheated.
So essentially this is what a cold air intake is, right? Or this is something far superior to a cold air intake.
Much superior
because
to that.
I think cold air intake is like just an air intake essentially.
But it's just an air intake, because ideally cold air, because most of the air intakes take it from the engine bay or the surrounding nearby it.
Okay.
This is compressed air conditioned air.
Wow.
So it has two modes, like while we're driving the AC is completely working fine and it's cooling the engine as well, and there is a drag mode in which the inside like
a drag mode?
Yeah. In which 100% of that cold air goes towards the engine, cooling the engine. So the inside temperature, like the air conditioning, will not work. Your blowers will work.
Okay.
But there will be no cold air, because that 100% cold air is diverted to the engine itself.
Okay.
So essentially keeps it happier, running quicker even in summers.
Of course.
And continuously. Otherwise, all these engines with the size, they overheat, and again the IATs shoot through the roof, and you don't get the same level of performance. So this essentially, after we run for like about an hour or 2 hour also, the car is always cold and in the same power range. The horsepower, the torque, nothing drops.
And have you taken this to BIC? I assume?
No, not as yet.
I mean,
we when we got the car, there was a lot of TLC required in terms of OEM parts also. Because
you bought it for how much, if I may ask?
That is, I forgot. I picked it up like 2 years back. But we continuously, like, with my thing is that I wanted to, like, I want everything to be perfect. So essentially we've changed, barring the aftermarket mods, whatever we've done. That's a huge list as well. But barring that, also everything OEM on this car, including the suspension, like battery, everything is brand new in this car. Like most of the mechanical parts are brand new. Crankshaft, crankshaft carrier, everything is new now. Essentially
new and not performance, like OE,
because there weren't performance options available for those things. But essentially, like, everything OE is also replaced, because at the end it is an old car.
But do tell me one thing, I mean, everything is OE and you're running practically in layman terms a stage 3, so to say.
Yeah.
Is it able to, when the hand, I mean, yeah. It seems like it's able to handle it quite well, because normally I think stage 3 you end up changing a lot of internals also, right?
Not necessarily.
In other cars.
Not necessarily. My VRS is also running like a stage 3, but again.
Stock internals.
That is okay. Around 450 horsepower. We've ran the car around 46,000 kilometers.
Okay.
It's full stage 3 setup, continuously pushing, track. Okay. Everywhere I've taken that car, but on stock internals. Once we're crossing on the VRS, there's a barrier of that 500 horsepower because it can't take more boost and everything.
Okay.
Then we have to upgrade the internals.
Okay. So till with 500, this, you don't need to do anything to the engine.
On the VRS, on the this, VRS. I'm saying the 700-800 horsepower also, the engine is also sorted, but again, because you're continuously pushing or launching the car, your drive shaft might break and fail. That's the only thing that has to be taken care of.
Okay.
Otherwise, like I'm saying, 800-900 horsepower for this car is like easy.
Wow.
And with plug-in play mods.
Torque figures?
Right now we're running 850 Nm of torque on the conservative map, which is decent enough for like a comfy car like this.
Okay.
So essentially this was like a sleeper build. That it doesn't get mistaken for a quick car, it gets mistaken for a A6 most of the time.
Yeah.
And whenever you want to floor
not
it.
Not to people like us.
Until unless I floor it, everyone's going to be like it's a A6 with a S6 kit or a badging on it.
Yeah,
because there's so few of these cars here.
Yeah, it's very subtle, I mean, in that sense.
Yeah. We've not put loud wheels on it or anything. Like, we've tried to keep it as subtle as possible.
True.
So, on the outside, I think the only mods I've done is just the wheels. Barring that, it's like the stock kit.
So, you've got turbos upgraded. You've got different... I mean, maps toh ek alag cheez hai hai.
Yeah.
A cooling mechanism.
Yeah.
And I guess
there is a lot of stuff which goes tiny stuff like upgraded coil packs.
Okay.
Again, tail waste gates, bar sensors, like a downpipe which is there.
Okay.
Then a super sprint exhaust which is also there.
Exhaust.
Yeah.
Of course.
And essentially that is more or less or maybe air intake which is what are we running? Armor speed carbon fiber air intake.
Okay.
Small bits and pieces like that which complete the package.
Correct. Air intake and exhaust to tune ke saath to aapko karna hi karna chahiye.
Correct. Essentially, is the turbos and the rest of the parts are just supporting mods.
Correct. So, stock power output was how much?
Stock around 400-420 horsepower.
Wow, dude. So, you're quite crazy with it.
Yeah. Essentially, it's an easy build, plug-and-play parts, but...
And it seems like the engine is quite durable. I mean, it's quite bulletproof, isn't it?
Yeah, the engine is quite bulletproof unless or until you mess around with like... too much this thing, or if you don't run it with proper fuel and you don't do the TLC.
So you're running with 95 right now?
Map right now is 95 for daily, but I usually prefer filling 100 in most of my cars.
Okay.
Like again, the fuel that we get here, ideally 95 octane is not 95 RON.
Okay.
So I prefer filling 100 most of the time. On the safer side, it's better, but we can obviously run like 95 as well.
I'm loving the suspension. I mean, I'm not feeling a thing.
Yeah.
And I'm too used to the Wrangler. I think it's just being tossed around like that.
Correct.
But yeah.
Plus, you don't feel the bumps and everything. That's why I didn't want to go away with the air suspension and this, no?
Oh, by the way, we're going to that place.
We'll just take a U-turn.
Got it.
From Mahamaya and just head back there.
Okay.
We just need a wide piece of road, but that's slightly tough.
You don't have a BOV,
no? No, not needed. We've got the updated base gates in this.
Okay. We're just for kicks.
Again, for me, it's more about the performance rather than the kicks. So it's always that if you're spending money, it has to be for some purpose or the other.
Of course.
Like if either it's adding reliability or it's adding performance. And we didn't think there were a lot of BOV options available.
Okay. There's a mad piece of equipment.
It's nice to cruise around with. Barring the fuel economy or the average of the car, which is a nightmare.
But
barring
I'm still scratching my head. Give me a rough figure of how much you picked it up for and how much did you end up investing on it on top of?
I'm seeing... or like essentially they're trading for 35 to 40 lakhs.
Okay. What year is this?
This is 2015. This is the ideally a 2013 manufactured car.
Okay.
As per my knowledge, I think we'd say 6S6 came into India. Everything came in 2013. So everything is 2013 manufactured.
Mm-hmm.
There is this white car. There is a silver car in Bangalore.
Mm.
And barring that, I think most of the S6, the other four are blue. All of them were registered in 2013.
Okay.
I'm not sure about it, but I think 90% I'm sure that all of them were registered in 13.
Huh.
This is the only car for some reason it got registered in 2015.
Okay.
So I have additional 2 years in Delhi. So
got,
yeah.
Nice.
So 35-40 is what the trading range is.
Okay.
Depending on the kilometers, because at the end of the day there are only a few people who sell like 6 cars. Okay. You know which car is getting traded where.
So I'll not get into how much you spent on it on top of it. So because
I'm saying a basic turbo, all the other stuff is like 15-20 lakhs at least. If you don't go around with the OEM stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
Like for example, when I swapped my suspension, I went with Blisteens, like the OEM manufacturer for it, which was some 4.5 lakh rupees.
Oh, you're running on Blisteens?
So the OEM factory ones are made from Blisteen only.
Oh, wow.
But there is a cheaper option of running a Chinese kit on it, which is about a lakh. But the point is, if you're driving a quick car and if you're driving it fast, you don't want to take that risk. No.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I'm saying 25,000 rupees a shocker compared to almost a lakh.
And honestly, I think it's better to go with what you know that it's a tried and tested thing.
Correct.
And I'm not saying that the other cheaper equipment might not work. It might just work equally good. But I think the best thing would be that even if you're investing more money, rather go for something that you know it'll work.
Yeah, but at the end of the day, if you know that you're going to drive fast, tomorrow what if it goes into a pothole and the back goes? Again, that reliability and comfort, that security in your head is not there.
Got it.
So even like a similar thing with wheels, you can obviously run like any sort of a rep wheel or anything at all.
Mm.
But at the end of the day, when it goes into a pothole, it might shatter or break.
Yeah.
At least you know with a branded wheel, it'll bend in the worst case scenario.
Mm-hmm.
You'll still be able to stop and save yourself.
Yeah.
The percentage is slightly higher.
Wow. Loving the way this thing handles.
That's wooden comfort so that you don't feel any bumps at all.
I thought that was comfort.
No, that was dynamic.
Cool, okay.